All right, hey guys, I think I'm online and I think the stream is up and it's going. So hello to everyone out there. Thank you for tuning in to another dual commentary match. So this is the match against Grandmaster Jan Gustafsson of Germany that was supposed to take place last week, but Chess24 had some technical issues, so it's taking place this week. And I just want to make sure you guys can all see me and hear me. Looks like you can. We've got the Team Scandi faithful already foaming at the mouth for the action today. How's it going, guys? Just give me a little shout out in the chat just to make sure. We are about 15 minutes until the top of the hour, and I'm just going to play a couple warm-up games. All right, perfect. Looks like everyone can hear and see me. Yeah, you like the little demo board up there? I decided to make this a true Team Scandi overture to you guys and actually put the Scandinavian defense up on my closet door on the board that this is a board I go around and teach with at schools and stuff. So I've had it for quite a while. Team Scandi hype is right, Luke. You guys are turning out in full force today. We have almost 100 people watching already, and we've still got 15 minutes to go before the match. So what's up to Coach Amur? What's up, Nicholas, Lorenzo, Kazi? I saw you in there too. Anton Squared Me, of course. Hello to a lot of new faces too. Mitria, Brain Freeze. How's it going, Francois? Thank you, Jeff. I hope that I do kill Jan, figuratively, on the chessboard. So just to recap the format, it's a race to 5 points. And I'll say this right before the match too, but it's a race to 5 points and draws do count. So if you get a half point from a draw, that counts towards your 5 point total. And we're going to start pretty soon. Jan and I had not discussed what happens in the event of a tie. So if we're at like 4.5, 4.5, and there's a draw, we have not discussed what will happen then. I was meaning to ask him about that, but it kind of slipped my mind. So most likely we'll just play to the next win, basically. So kind of sudden death. What's up, Stefan? Lucas, how's it going? Thank you, Gary. I appreciate it. All right, so just to make sure that everything is working on Chess24 and I get some practice playing, let's play a few games. I know we've got, okay, I'm probably going to play a 1 minute game instead. Oh, Coach Amur. All right, I got to play Coach Amur. He's a very consistent viewer. And here we go. I am white. Coach Amur's rating is really low on this site. What's up with that? 1695? Dude, you're like 2300 on Lee Chess. Come on now. All right, so we're playing some sort of, I don't know, semi-slav where I'm offering the c4 pawn, but Coach Amur didn't take it. Maybe this is a Coach Amur imposter. Maybe it's not actually the real Coach Amur. I guess that's possible. Okay, I'm going to go here and just defend my d-pawn. Let's open this up, maybe. Let's see if we can get a capture in the center. We'll do this, pull it back. Okay, let's close the position. And maybe go with like h4, h5. I don't think I can draw arrows on here, but I'll be talking about my moves as I play them, of course, as usual. This looks pretty standard so far. I'm going to kick this knight out of here. It was bugging me. Okay, maybe h5 now. There's this pin going on, so I can try to take advantage of that. Let's actually go here. Little sneaky move. Maybe bishop b5, maybe bishop d3 action. Something like that, I'm thinking. Okay, let's do this. And then I'm going to pull this back and try to attack g6 with the entire weight of my army. So I'm trying to crash through on this square. Coming for you, Coach Amur. All right, let's take that. Kind of slow on here. I got to pick up my speed. This is 5-0, no increment. Oh, he moved already. Okay, well, let's back this up. Yeah, I'm definitely a little slower than usual. He's going to take that. Okay. Coach Amur, man, slow down, dude. Whoa, that was a mouse slip. All right, so just like last week, before we start the match, we actually lose a game. All right, Coach Amur, let's rematch. That was a warm up, but you played well. You checkmated me on G2. Okay, so waiting for him to play. Bullet is the only time control where I've actually played rated on Chess24. So let's see how this works out. Okay, I'm gonna play D6. Maybe we'll go for a King's Indian. A little King's Indian defense against Mr. Kochamura. Let's advance in the center, try to break up his structure a bit. Not a terrible thing to lose your first game because you can only go up from there, right? You've already let the wave of disappointment of a loss wash over you. You can only go up from that point forward. Okay, I'm gonna take and then maybe play knight d4. Yeah, probably knight d4. This knight is supported by my bishop, so it looks okay. I guess I'm inviting. He had knight c7 there. I was inviting that. Let's go here and offer a queen trade, attack his bishop. Okay, so I'm up a pawn. Pretty solid position. Let's offer another trade. I'm liking this. Knight c2 is a threat. He saw it. Okay, let's bring this into the center. Because why not? King e3, I have knight c2, so that probably would not have been good for him. Okay, let's take. Gonna take here. He can play rook a1 and then go after my pawn on a7, although he kind of gets trapped if he does that, so I think this should turn out well. Let's do this. Let's give a check here. I'm gonna go rook d2 next. Pick up this pawn. Bring this back. Let's go here. I'm up on time. Pin that knight. Go take this next. Right, so we're gonna win that game. But Kochamura got some of my rating points. Some of my hard-earned Chess24 rating points. And we're about 5 minutes from the start, so I'm not gonna play hardly any other longer games. Probably just another bullet game or two. How many people are we up to in the stream? 356. Awesome. Good to see. All right, so let's see what other challenges we got here. Elekin. Okay, 2296. Let's take this player. Okay, I'm gonna go knight f3. And this guy, Elekinin, has a picture of Nakamura on his profile here. Intimidating. Okay. Let's play c4 and knight c3. King's Indian defense. Oh, I was gonna take on e5, but he didn't let me. Let's go bishop e3 now and support the center. Standard stuff. Okay, whoops, I actually meant to play b3 there, but that's all right. Let's keep this dark square bishop. Why not? Play knight d5. If you play c6, we get into b6, so that could be okay. Let's do this. Maybe f5 is a good idea for him. I'm gonna go here. Maybe tuck my bishop away. I think that would be smart. Let's go attack that knight. Not rightly sure if it's a good plan, but we'll see. Ooh, free pawn. Gives a check. Okay. Let's do this. If he takes a3, I take c7. I like that. Okay, so now we can defend. Gonna bring my rook over. And we're gonna pile up on that pawn, basically. Let's play g3, attack his knight, kick it out of there. Let's see if we can get a swap, because then I can bring my rook over to g3. Aha. Well, now he's going to lose that piece. No doubt about it. Whoops. I'm slipping a lot on here. See if we can take and bludgeon through in the center. Now we win his queen. Oh, take that. And we've got mate coming up. All right, so we dispatch Elekinin. Recover some of our points. And just checking the chat here. Thank you all for tuning in despite the technical difficulties last week. So if you're just joining, this is a match against German Grandmaster Jan Gustafsson of Chess24. It's a race to 5 points, 5+0 time control, no increment whatsoever. And I did a little bit of prep for this match. I kind of just thought about which openings I'm going to play. I will tell you that I'm going to try to surprise Jan a little bit. So Jan is an excellent theoretician. I'm going to try to get him on his back foot early in the match and take the psychological initiative. All right, because this is a pretty short match. I mean, first to 5 points, a lot of it depends on the momentum. And I think the player who can reel off a couple early victories is probably going to win this thing. That's my thought. So, okay, Jan is ready. And you guys ready to do this? Team Scandi? All right, so we've got our first game coming right up. And I am accepting here. And we are off to the races. Okay, I'm white. First game. I'm opening with knight f3. I'm just gonna kind of feel him out in the openings. Jan is pretty classical. I mean, he plays pretty close to the vest with both colors. And if I can get some playable positions out of the opening, I'll be happy. Just going into the middle game, I'll be completely pleased with the positions. So, okay, let's castle here. If he plays knight c6, I'll probably play d4. Yeah, let's go d4. See if he wants to transpose into maybe a reversed Grünfeld, something of that nature. Yeah, I'll take and play c4. I'll try to put some pressure on his center. Okay, so here I can play knight c3 or queen a4. I have a feeling knight c3 is the move, so let's do that. So this is a true reverse Grünfeld, so an extra tempo for white. But I have not played this position before. Maybe one time I've played it. But it's been a while, so. Okay, here I think I'm going to play queen a4 and try to put pressure on d5 a little indirectly. Okay, so he defends with that move. Makes a lot of sense. So if I trade, take on d7, he can take with his king at the end. But then his king seems a little awkwardly placed, does it not? So maybe I can do this and look for an endgame. So if king takes, I feel like rook d1 and pile up on this pinned pawn. And he's just going to give that pawn. Interesting decision. So maybe I can avoid taking it for now. I'm thinking about stuff like bishop g5. I can take d5, but I kind of see his point. I think he's going to trade everything, play king e6 at the end, and claim that he has some compensation. Is that really true, though? So if I play bishop g5, what about knight g4? That's one move that kind of concerns me here. I could play h3, but it seems a little slow. Not bad though. Okay, let's do this. I'm not taking the pawn on d5. I don't want to cede the initiative. I have a feeling if there are all those trades, the king comes out and he's going to have some comp because I'm underdeveloped, my dark square bishop and my rook. So I'm trying to prepare bishop g5 here, pressure the knight, get at d5. Thank you to those who are taking time out of their schedule to tune in. I know this is not exactly the most convenient time for US viewers in particular, and I appreciate everyone who is tuning in around the world. I mentioned this before, but that's what I love about chess, the fact that it's just such an international game. And maybe a little bit later, or even now, put in the chat where you're tuning in from. Where do you live? Because I have a lot of American and European viewers, but I don't want to count out other people from different parts of the world too. Like, for instance, Squash Addict. If you're out there, Squash Addict from Australia, he's very faithful. He always tunes in. And probably for an Australian, some of these stream times are at really weird hours. Okay, Jan's thinking here a long time. So, Bishop G5? Guess I'm going to do that. And he quickly plays that. Makes sense. So if I take, take, play knight e4, he has to go bishop e7. That seems to be okay. So maybe I should play e3 instead. But e3, e3, I'm not so certain about. Maybe I can take, take, and then play knight e4 and e3. Could also play knight e4 right here, but. Decisions. If I play e3 now, king e8, let's say take f6, pawn takes, knight e4, he might be able to take on e3. Yeah, I don't know about that. Not quite sure about that one. Take knight d5 is also an option. Albeit a strange looking one. No, I'm taking a little bit of time here, but I want to get this right. Yeah, very tough to say. Take knight d5 is quite interesting. I think I'm gonna do that. So, an unusual maneuver. I'm in some respects worried that my knight will get stuck here, but I am attacking the f6 pawn. That's my hope. But I wonder if he could play f5 and just dare me to go take his h pawn, because probably I shouldn't go take the h pawn. Maybe if f5, I can play b4? Or f4 doesn't look so good. B4. B4 is interesting. Let's try it. So attack his bishop. I'm down on the clock, so I gotta pick up the pace. If he retreats the bishop all the way to, say, f8, I might play e3 then, I'm thinking. Although then he can just take on e3. Check, followed by take h7. Greedy, very greedy. It's gonna get a lot of play. F4. Let's try it. I don't want to fall into a prospectless position, so I'm trying to use my pawn breaks aggressively. E4 in reply. Okay, let's come here. Trying to tear down his structure. Also, maybe win his h pawn if I can. Problem is, I have 55 seconds. Okay. Do take. Okay, I'm gonna do this and then bring the knight back to h5 and try to get it to f4 if I can. He can just take b4 now, though. Bishop c3, perhaps. I do have my knight coming to d3. That's a threat. Although I don't know if it's a big one. So he's up a pawn, kind of shattered structure, but we'll see what happens. Okay, I'm gonna come here. Maybe get rook b7 in if I can. My pawn on a2 is hanging, however. Okay, get rook b7 in. I'm not gonna play knight d3 check quite yet. I want to hold off on that move. Okay, now I'm gonna do it. Bring our rook over. Try to hit f5, maybe. g4 could come. Somewhat scrambling for counterplay, though. Think I'm taking a little too long in the middle game. Gotta go quick. Take on f5, bishop e4. That's the plan. Take that. Is he just gonna ignore it? Play like bishop d5? Because if he takes, bishop e4 looks bad. Okay, let's give a check. See where we can force his king. Give another check. Let's go here, maybe knight g4. D3 might be good here. Ooh, check. This is a big turnaround, potentially. Let's see if he trades. I mean, his a pawn is strong, though, is the thing. Let's get behind that pawn. We don't want to just lose it. Okay, let's bring this up. very unclear position with no time for either of us, really. Okay, let's bring this over. He could take that pawn. Ooh, clever. Clever. He wanted bishop d4. So I'm trying to stop his pawns here. Okay, very clever once again for him. I gotta go after him with checks here. Oh! That was a complete swindle. But this is what can happen with no increment, you know? It's like just a time scramble at the end. Clearly, I got extremely lucky there. I had one pawn remaining. That was my ticket to the win versus it just being a draw. So, I mean, I feel bad about that, but at the same time, it's a time scramble. Anything can happen. No increment blitz. So we take the first game. Someone said no in the chat. I think there's a little bit of delay as you're seeing on the screen in the chat. All right, so that's flagging right there. Flagging 101. And I'm sure Jan is going to try to come roaring back in the second game. So I've accepted his challenge, and we're off to the races. Okay, so this is what I mean by trying to take the psychological initiative early on. All right, so I got to capitalize on this first victory. Okay, let's play the bishop to g7. All right, I think I'm going to play c5 and maybe go for a Benko Gambit. He could play e4 here and take it into a Meroxy type position if he wants. Let's see if he does that, because I know that's in his repertoire. If he plays e4, I might play knight c6, though, and try to persist. Okay, we're going to have this. Kind of a delayed Benko Gambit. I don't know what Jan plays against the Benko, so this will be a complete mystery. The score is 1-0 me so far. Chess24 doesn't display the score. I wish there was kind of a counter or something, but yeah, it's 1-0 thus far. Okay, I wonder if he's going to go for this kind of trendy idea with an early a4 from white. He very well might do that. Okay, so he's just playing queen e2. Let's go, knight g4, he can play knight d2. I can play queen b6, perhaps. Yeah, let's go queen b6. And he does go for an early a4, all right. Now, how to contest this? I'm thinking about playing queen here, to be perfectly honest. Now let's play rook b8 first, though. I'm a little worried about a quick e5, but I think in this position, he's probably going to develop or somehow play an improving move, like maybe rook e1 or something like that. He might go for e5, but if e5, I guess I can play knight g4 and start maneuvering for the center. That last game was intense. I mean, I was certainly defending for the majority of it. I feel like I had more chances in the opening, but maybe squandered some of them. Here, bishop g5 makes sense, attacking the pawn on e7. I don't know if he's actually threatening to win that pawn, because in a lot of cases you can play f6 and trap their piece when they play this way. But I'm going to err on the side of caution and just defend it with my king. Now I want to go knight c7 next, that's my plan. Just try to contest this knight. He could play knight d2 and try to angle for the c4 square, knight c4. Yeah, he's going to do that. Good idea. Okay, I better play this way. Just checking something. Maybe queen a6 first. Nah, but queen a6, I can't go knight c7 then. So if knight c7, knight c4, queen b7, I'm just wondering if he can, like, sack on e7 and then go hog wild towards my king. I'm slightly worried about that. Now, you know what? In the interest of trying to, again, take the psychological initiative early on, I'm going to tempt him with some sacrifices. on e7 or d6. Bishop takes e7 is very interesting. I don't know how inclined he will to be to make that sacrifice, but at least I'm putting him to a test. A simple decision would just be knight takes c7 here, or maybe like knight c2 a3, trying to defend the center. Yes, Jacob, king f8 is a slightly ugly move, I agree. No doubt about that. He's thinking. Yeah, no doubt he's looking at the permutations of sacrifices. I mean, bishop takes e7 if he's going to sacrifice is the most promising way to do it. I'm pretty positive. Bishop takes e7, king takes e7, and then one of the knights taking on d6. It's hard to calculate all that. It's going to give chances to both sides, I think. Yeah, he's playing it safe. Makes sense. Now I don't mind my position so much, though. Maybe knight e5, try to get rid of his knight. He has knight b6 then. Rook b4, he has bishop back to d2. Rook b3, maybe. Yeah, maybe rook b3. Let's try that one. You can play knight b6 here. Okay, he just plays rook a3. So if I take, he takes with the pawn, I'm guessing. Take, pawn takes, knight e5. Bishop back to d2 then? Looks odd, but probably decent. If rook b4, bishop back to d2 as well. Okay, I'm going to try this. I got to get rid of this knight. I can't let this knight stick around on c4. It's too strong. It restricts my knight. Yeah, so he plays that. Now here, I was thinking of trying to get my queen in somehow, but I see there's a problem now. Okay, maybe queen here. This knight b6 still, though. That troubles me. Yeah, there it comes. Okay, so let's do... Ugh. Okay, I'm going to try this. Rook b1 looks good. Semi-gross position here. I'm probably just in big trouble. Knight d7 is a threat. Big threat. Okay, I think I'm going to try to run away with my king. And his rook is undefended on b1, so at least there's that to consider. But, yeah, I don't have a good way to get rid of his knight, really. This is not good. And queen e8's a big threat here, too. Okay, let's try to make a space for our king to roam. I don't see an immediate breakthrough for him, but I also don't... Oh, he's just going to play f4. Yeah, f4 is strong here. Eh, that's no good. This game is resignable. Try one last move. But I think if he plays like bishop c3, something like that, I'll just have to give it up. My knight is stuck. Stuck in the center. Yeah, I don't see any way I can truly confuse the issue here. If I could get at his e4 pawn, I would have a chance. But as it stands, not seeing anything. Okay, time to resign this one. Nice game by Jan. So he just held on to the pawn and subsequently converted. So 1-1, just going to hit the rematch button. Yep, 1-1, Tomek is right. That's the current score. I'm going to go back to knight f3. See if Jan repeats the same line. He very well might, or he might do something different. You never know. Okay, let's castle here. See what he's up to. He's going to take the center aggressively. Yeah, e5. So I could play d4, but he's going to go e4. I might just want to play some King's Indian attack style position from here. Let's play c4. We'll challenge the center that way. Okay, so he takes, probably check. Knight c6, yep, makes sense. Let's regain that pawn. Just play d3, so we might have like a reversed Sicilian sort of position. I'm gonna go bishop g5 just to see if I can induce some weakness, like get him to play h6 or something, and maybe play off that in the future. Here I'm thinking pull back to c1, which supports my bishop. So now if h6, I can just take the pawn. So he plays f6 instead. Makes sense. Okay, let's go bishop h6. I want to see if he is willing to trade the bishops. Just keeps his there, okay. Let's bring this knight into the game. So reverse Sicilian. And now that's a sign for me to take. If knight e4, probably b6 is his plan. But actually, that's not such a bad move to induce, I think, so I'll do that. He doesn't want a knight to make an appearance on c5, so I think b6 is very likely, even though it weakens some squares on this diagonal. We're at 700 viewers. Wow. How's it going, guys? Okay, so maybe rook d1? I think knight d4 is coming. I'd like to play something a little more forceful here, like a sack on f6 or something. That would actually be very interesting. I wonder if you could take out this king in that case, though. Yeah, it's probably unsound. How about g4, g5? But g4, he's going to play knight d4 and then hit my pawn on e2. So probably I need kind of a consolidating move like this. Rook d1. And maybe try to get e3 in. Maybe I could have played e3 on the previous move, in fact. That might have been better. Okay, I think I'm gonna drop this back. Even though that looks like a bit of a concession, I need to defend e2 more reliably. And also, my bishop is staring at that rook on a8 now. Okay. Thinking about knight d2 and trying to maneuver. Now, let's just play e3. I think he's going to take and then play c5, but at least we've got rid of the threat on d4. Okay. Let's do this. Maybe position my queen on b2, stare at his king on the long diagonal. So I'm adopting sort of a hedgehog formation. It's a little bit passive, though, is the only thing I don't like about it. Let's go here. Someday I'd love to play d4, however. If I could get the d4 break in, that would be nice. Okay, let's bring this over. I'm playing slower than him. Need to pick up the pace. He's 26, 26 FIDE, but no reason for me to give him this much respect. Good player, but still human after all. Okay, let's double up our rooks. Maybe soften him up on the king side after this somehow. I'm thinking. Knight e4. Can I maneuver and keep my knight? Probably asking for it if I do. I think I'm just going to swap. D4. Let's play H4. Yeah, strategically, this is very nice for black, I think now. I need to get D4 in. Can I do it now? D4, trade, trade, trade. I get check in at the end. All right, let's try it. This might be a bad decision. We'll see. He might take once and then play E4. That's certainly an option. but I want to break free. I don't want to just sit here passively. You know what the bad thing is? I'm not threatening anything, really. Well, I guess I am threatening to take. He's leading with his queen, so that means I can potentially trade two rooks for a queen if the position so desires it. Okay, I predict he's going to play e4. Because I don't think he wants to take and allow take, and then after all the trades, I get queen e7 check in, and I win f6. And then I have a queen plus pawn against two rooks, and his king is kind of open. I mean, he could play that way. That's probably fine, but I just doubt he'll do it. So if e4, probably queen e3, I'm thinking. I might want to take the file, too. Maybe rook c1, in fact. Kind of switch targets a little bit. Yeah, let's go rook c1. I know I have to keep a close eye on d4. But maybe, just maybe, I can switch the focus of my play. I'm getting some counterplay, I feel. Okay, d5 is a breakthrough, but is it any good? Probably not. I have a couple checks, but that's it. Actually, it's kind of interesting. That, like, almost works. d5. Thing is, he could just ignore it. Yeah, I shouldn't waste too much time calculating it. d5, rook takes check. This rook to d7. You know what? It's interesting. d5 queen here. Well, that. Okay, I'm going to try it. This is risky, but let's get rid of the pawn and open some lines. This is a decision I'm making partly based on the clock and how long I took to calculate that. I probably should have just made some other move if I wasn't going to take it. I have some ideas in mind. So, like, if he plays this rook to d7, I have queen d4. Okay, against that one, I was thinking I had some idea in mind. Okay, let's give a check here. Might not work, but we'll find out. King h7, take, take. And then rook c8, I think, is what I'm going to do. He's going to come there. Okay. Well, let's take here, first of all. He's going to take with his queen, most likely. Okay, so let's try to keep material on board and go after his king. His king is open, no doubt. I mean, queen h8 could be coming. Queen d4, probably a good move. Okay, I'm going to take and go check and just play for a7. This endgame should be a draw, but I don't know. With my time, hard to say. Don't think he should have allowed me that move, though. Let's go here. Okay, now a5 could be coming, if he's not careful. I'm going to offer him a draw, see if he takes it. Alright, yeah, drawn game. So, that was maybe generous of him, because I had twice less time as he did, but I don't know, the position is objectively drawn. So, that was a very interesting one. I think when I had that pawn on d3... I was under some pressure. Jan did a good job of controlling matters, and he maybe could have played better right around here, I feel. I'm not sure even taking the pawn is right. I mean, maybe queen e5 or something? He could just ignore it if he wants, but he took right away. Like, you know, he didn't seem to believe this, maybe rightly so. It's possible if I have compensation, it's only, like, just enough. It's not anything more than compensation. So, all right, next game, 1.5, 1.5. Yes, Coach Murray, Jan is a nice guy. And Jan is the master of dry humor, too. Let that be known. Okay, so I'm black in this game. I'm expecting another d4, but we'll see. I'm probably not going to play d4, d5, even though that's what I usually do. out of deference to Jan's theoretical knowledge. I feel like I have better chances in a bit more unbalanced positions. So, okay, we're waiting for this game to start. There we go. Okay, so let's go back to g6 again. See if he sticks to the same plan. Nope, he's going to mix it up a little bit. All right. Let's play this Gurgenidze that I've often played against Danny Rensch and our chess rivals. So, we'll go d5 here. Mm-hmm, he's going to play kind of a restriction game. Makes a lot of sense. Okay, I'm going to take. And then play knight d7. And I'm going to try to go knight gf6 on the next move. White can get some space advantage out of this, but it's a reasonable position for black at the same time. So if knight gf6 is bishop takes f7 a concern. Kind of a ridiculous looking sacrifice take. Knight g5, king back. I don't think I can be scared of that. Yeah, that was not going to work for white, so I'm glad I didn't back down from that. Okay, so black clearly has a kind of a bad light square bishop, but I can try to get it in the game via b6 and bishop b7, so that's what I'll do. I'm going to try to develop it via that b7 square. I do have to worry about knight e5, however. Okay, let's just play h6, kick him back a little bit. Let's go here, attack that dark square bishop. He wants to hone in on those potential light square weaknesses. Makes sense. Okay, we're going to go here. Let's pre-move this capture. Got to get that bishop in the game. That's imperative. Oh, why, thank you, Mark, but I don't believe that. No, Jan is the master of dry humor. So I will respectfully disagree with you, even though you're giving me a nice compliment. All right, so the dark square bishops have been exchanged. I mean, no doubt white's more comfortable here. They probably have a small edge, objectively. I feel like my position shouldn't be so bad, especially if later I can play c5. I might want to play c5 right now to try to gain some play. Might be the right call. Otherwise, it could take a while to get that move in. Yeah, let's do it. Let's go for the gusto. So have that bishop participating in the struggle down this diagonal. I do accept a kind of a weak pawn, though, on c5, so there's no doubting that. Maybe queen e7 or queen g5. I'm worried about knight coming to d7 a little bit. How about rook b8? Kind of a weird-looking move. Yeah, let's try it. I wonder if he could take and then swing his queen over to c3. I guess I have queen f6 in that case, though. Ah, but now there's always this knight d7 fork idea, isn't there? That might have been a mistake by me. We'll find out. Yeah, I think he sees it. So queen over to c3. That's annoying. Yeah, because if I move my king, I think knight g4 is pretty bad. So I might be forced to play... I might be forced to play queen f6 and sack the exchange. Maybe that exchange sack isn't all that bad, though. We'll find out. He could also take on c5, but if he takes c5, I could play a rook to c8 and maybe get some play out of this deal. Okay, so let's take that. Now I'm thinking rook into b2. We'll try to gain some traction this way. Let's leave those weak pawns where they're at. You know, right now I don't have anything to show for my material, but if I can go after these weak pawns and maybe win one of them, that'll be an achievement. Also, if I take the a-pawn, I'll have a passed a-pawn myself. Strong bishop on d5. So he's going to give that pawn right away, huh? Okay, we got to take it. Yeah, he's fighting for open lines for his pieces. I mean, I can completely understand where he's coming from here. So if I take here, is his idea rook b1? So I'm thinking that's his plan. think I'm still going to take it. I got to defend this. He is going rook b1. Can I still take? Or bishop b7 first, maybe. I always have e5. That's one nice thing. I can always play e5 to save myself. Okay, I'm going to take here. So I can play this pawn up if I need to defend f7, is my thinking. So let's just keep grabbing pawns and make him figure it out. Yeah, he does that. Makes sense. Bishop b7. Or bishop d5, rather. Guarding b7, I should say. Okay, let's go here, yeah. Minute 47. Mm-hmm. So I can give a check and then play rook here again. Can also maybe just play bishop a2. Or bishop b3, perhaps. Yeah, let's go bishop b3. He's trying to go rook d7, clearly, so I need to do something about that. Bishop back to d7 or to d5 rather. Let's do that. Attack the rook. Not quite sure. I mean, I want to go e5 and defend my pawn, but it's not super simple. Okay, so he's going to force me to do that. Now maybe king f6, bishop back to e6, and pawn c4. It's been suggested in my announcement videos, several people have commented that they think that Jan is weaker in the endgame. They think the endgame is Jan's weakness. So I hope I can somehow prove that. Don't know if I'll be able to. Okay, better do this. Mm-hmm. E3, maybe. Yeah, let's do that. And then I'm going to play bishop to d5 hereafter and try to take g2 with check. Does it work, though? I don't know. It might not work. We'll see. He has rook d7 at the end, but I'm not sure that actually is good for him. King there. Right. He has king e2. And then I gotta go here. Yeah, that's bad for me. I don't have a tactical resource in reply. If bishop f5, rook takes f5. Ouch, I got caught. Ah, that's too bad. Yeah, I had a good game going there. But just didn't play correctly right around here with e3. I guess I should just play c4. Yeah, because I can always play c3 later if necessary, I think. So, that's too bad. Chances spoiled in this game. Otherwise, that exchange sacrifice yielded some decent results. It was like a unintentional exchange sacrifice when everything is said and done. Because, you know, queen c3, I didn't see this in advance. Only after I played rook b8 did I realize that there might be some issues with knight d7. But good game from Jan, being tricky and keeping the pressure on me with little time. Wonder if I could have saved it anywhere towards the end. I think at this point I'm already in trouble. Although I guess here I could have played bishop f3. Yeah, bishop f3 would have worked. So just do that. And then he can't harass my bishop. He could try to gang up on f7. It's still going to be a tough defense. And I don't know if I'd be able to hold here with the time situation. But that would have saved me at least in the short term. Yep, so 2.5, 1.5. And we've got our other challenge going on here. Let's accept. So Jan is ahead by a game. All right. We're sticking with knight f3. I know I haven't really got much with white, but I feel I gotta stick with this move anyways. And he's gonna play the same g6 system. Let's see if he takes the center again with this. Okay, I'm gonna repeat this line, even though I'm not quite sure about it. Maybe knight a3 this time. Knight a3 would be intriguing, wouldn't it? Nah, let's go queen a4. I'm gonna do the same thing. And then take. Okay, we'll play d3 once more. I didn't mind the position I got after bishop g5. It was playable, I feel. Okay, bring this guy back. Maybe here I'll try something different. Bishop d2. Nah. I keep saying I'm going to do something different, but I'm going to play exactly the same way. All right, let's take this one. So last time I did knight c3, and then I went knight e4, but he just always played b6 when I did that. You can play knight bd2, but is the knight really headed for a better square? Let's just do this. Okay, bring this over to defend the center. This time I might play e3 to try to deny the knight the use of the d4 square. Unless he jumps in now. If he jumps in now, I might have to react to it. He certainly could play that way. He does. So maybe play b4. b4, bishop g4, though. I do not like it. Okay. Trade off. These 2600s are tough, man. I'm not getting anything in the opening. Their opening prep is just on point. All right, gotta take here. Now, can I go after these weak pawns? Like knight e4 or something like that. Or knight b5. Nah, probably not working. Let's stick with knight e4. Queen takes c7 is the threat. Knight d5 might be a reasonable reply. Holds this pawn. It does block the d-file, but it holds the pawn, and I think that's probably most important to him. Just going to retreat. I'm a little surprised by that. Okay, let's go b4. I think he's still going to play b6, because I believe he wants to deny my knight the use of the c5 square, but surprised that he didn't want to keep his queen out on g4, where it was kind of threatening. Up to almost 800 viewers in the stream. Almost 800 on the nose. Awesome. Okay, d4 here, maybe? Time to advance. D4, f5, though. That's something, though. Let's get rid of this backward pawn. Be confident, John. Let's play with some fire here. Give me the fire emoticon in chat, guys. Team Scandi, I'm calling on you guys. So I was thinking f5, and then after the knight moves, play e4 and like close it up. He could try that. Let's say f5, knight c3, maybe. I could also go to d2, although d2 doesn't look quite as good. Let's go to c3. Now we'll see if he takes or keeps the tension. Okay, so here he might be planning to blockade on d5, so I'm thinking maybe play d5 myself before he gets a chance to do that. Yeah, let's do that. He can't take the pawn because he's leading with his queen here. I only have two defenders, but if he takes, I take, and queen takes would drop material. All right, yeah, fire emoticons. Let's do this. Thank you, guys. Also, d5 makes it a little uncomfortable for his c-pawn. Can't push that pawn without it being captured. Okay, so he's going to bring his knight around to blockade. Let's go here and maneuver. Maybe I can get my knight up to f4. If I can go knight f4 and into e6, he could be in trouble here. That could be something. Something pretty significant, too. I mean, he might have to take immediate action to try to avoid that danger. Okay, now we've pulled slightly ahead of him on the clock. I'll take that. Wow, c6. That's not a move that I would expect to be good here. Doesn't that just drop a pawn? I'm confused. So if I take, you're taking here? Is that what you're saying, Jan? I don't believe it. Which way to take, though? Okay, I'm just going to take with a pawn. I mean, he could take on d1 and trade some stuff off, but I've got an extra c-pawn. So, I don't know about that. Very odd decision. Maybe he felt like there was too much pressure already, though. Okay, now rook into d7 becomes tantalizing. This is my game to win at this stage. Absolutely no question about it. Okay, let's play b5 and just support the c6 pawn. Let's get our rook in here. Defend our a pawn. a6. I could play knight d4. I could also just take. I mean, taking looks pretty darn good. Yeah, let's just take. If rook a8, I have a7. Holding everything. Knight d4 here, I was thinking. Support the c-pawn. Also threatening knight b5. Importantly. Okay, I can play c7 now. I could also give a check. But if I give a check, he takes c6, so let's not do that. Let's just play c7. I mean, how does he defend? Rook d8 is coming. Looks very, very bad. Also, I have knight b5 almost whenever I want. Yeah, the truth is he can't really move here. Okay, this is going to lose, though. Take the knight, and he's going to play on down a piece. Give a check and go after the b-pawn. Just a pure piece. All right, so we win that game. 2.5, 2.5. So it seemed like my d5 move really rattled him or something on move 22. Because, okay, knight c8 might be inaccurate if I'm going to start maneuvering my knight, like knight e2 and get it into d4 or f4. But, I really was surprised that he reacted that way. It might have just been a blunder. You never know. People make blunders. It happens. So it could have just been a straight-up mistake by him. Thank you, guys. The fire emoticons have been helping. Keep it going. Don't spam the chat with fire emoticons all the time, I mean, but I think that had something to do with that last victory. Okay, here we go. It's 2.5, 2.5. Let's get this thing going. This is anybody's ball game. I think that last game just gave me some confidence. Much needed confidence boost. Okay, so let's... He's going to play it this way. Okay, I'm still going to go c6. We'll see what he wants to do. Knight bd2. All right, I'm not going to play d5. I'm going to play d6 and mix it up a little bit. e5 is very interesting here, but nah, I'm just going to develop. It's castle. I'm going to try to slowly implement e5. Like, let's go here now. He can push. Pushing is interesting. I'll play knight d5 in that case. So if e5... Yeah, I could probably do it now. Let's play it. He takes. Here I was thinking take with the knight. If I take with the pawn, knight c4, queen c7. Actually, that's probably okay too. Let's do this. We're in some kind of King's Indian territory now. Seems to me. I mean, I am a little worried about b3, bishop a3 ideas from him. So let's go here. If he does that, I might eventually have to play c5 if the pressure on this diagonal becomes too much. Yeah, he's gonna play that way. Makes a lot of sense. Maybe b5. Maybe I gotta be aggressive here and just play for b5. Try to kick his knight out. Let's do it. Trade the pawns. I just don't want him settling that knight on c4 in conjunction with a bishop coming to a3. I think I have big problems on the d6 square. c5 would be a weakness if I had to play it, so we're gonna do it this way. You think so, Stefan? You think the King's Indian is a good way to go against Jan? I don't know. I have very limited knowledge of the King's Indian. I wouldn't quite call this a King's Indian. This is like a poor man's King's Indian. D6, C6, Queen C7, etc. He's thinking a little bit here. Not sure what about, because I mean, I guess he can move the knight, and maybe he's thinking. Okay, so yeah, because if I play A6, I would lose a pawn, I suppose, is his contention here. Maybe knight c5 and try to go take that bishop, but that bishop's kind of weak anyways. Maybe rook b8. Let's go rook b8 and just defend this way. Let's pre-move this. Bishop a3, all right. Again, he's goading us. He's goading us into playing this move. But do we really want to? Don't think so. Okay, let's come here. I might want to play bishop f8 soon and try to swap those dark square bishops. Ah, the grandmaster maneuver. Bishop to b4, stopping me from going a5 and maybe looking for a5 himself. Well played, sir. Okay, let's come here. So bishop here, knight b6, at least I'll have an opened up an attack on his bishop. Knight h5 maybe. Fear my knight could be out of play there though. But probably it's at least as good as any alternative I'm seeing here. Knight c5, there's bishop a5, so I can't really do that. I could play rook over. I think he's gonna go for c4 pretty soon though. No, actually, let's bail with the rook. I'm gonna try to stay flexible. I think rook d8 might have been a mistake in view of what he did with his bishop. So I'll try to correct this error. Thank you to Starbucks for keeping me caffeinated through this match. All right, bishop a5, queen b7, or knight b6? I think I might want the flexibility. There's also queen a7, too. Let's play queen a7. I might want to play my bishop to b7. Okay, here I was thinking play b4, but is there some big reason not to? Maybe not. What about take? What if I take? Take, knight takes, rook takes b3. Can I get away with that? Looks risky. Looks very risky. At the very least. All right, I'm gonna go b4. I always have bishop f8 if I need to defend this pawn better, so let's do that. Hopefully, I can use the c5 square to blockade. That's my intention coming up. Okay, so let's do this. Maneuvering. I really want to go knight c5, but this rook takes b4 then. trying to make that work somehow, but I don't think it works. It just doesn't work. Okay. Let's come here. Threatening knight f4. I'm thinking maybe knight g7 to e6. Try to maneuver in that via that square. Looks interesting. We're both picking up the pace, that's for sure. What to do here? Okay, knight in, take. Just nothing really coming of that. Okay, let's do this. I should know which way I'm going to take back, but I don't. Okay, I'm going to take with a pawn. We're going to try our best here. I would drop material. Yikes. Okay, let's go here. I might just lose the b4 pawn this way, but I got to do something quick. He started to blitz me out. He senses weakness. Left. Far too little. Now it's just got to be instantaneous moves. Ah, knight f6, blunder. Immediate blunder. Okay, well, maybe I'll have some compensation. At least I'll tell myself that. D3, hopefully. Okay, let's go for this. I'm thinking of going for rook d2. I don't even think it works, though. But I'll try it, at least. He saw my intention here. I'm trying to attack. It's not simple. Okay, take that. Whoa, take it. He's going to be up a pawn when all is said and done, though. Check. You just take with his rook. Okay, yeah, we lost that game. I spent too much time trying to figure out how to maneuver in a position where I think I just had to make moves, basically. We can actually see the move time. So in the middle game, I spent quite a bit. Yeah, right around here. When he did this whole bishop b4, bishop a5 thing. I think that impressed me more than it should have. I should have just started responding and reacting. But I sat there and all of a sudden it was just a few quick decisions by him and I was down like 2 minutes on the clock. So, all right, so we're down 3.5 to 2.5. There's still everything to play for though. If we get a win here, we're right back where we need to be. So I'm gonna stick with the same opening and I'm gonna try to play it fast too. This is like turning into a thematic match. Okay, he's mixing it up too, though. It's castle. We'll go for this line again. I really didn't mind how this turned out the first time around. Let's see if he's willing to repeat it. Okay, so last time I took and played check. That seemed to be okay, but maybe I can do better. Nah, let's do it again. If I have some sort of refinement here, that would be nice. But, okay, let's work d1. It's still bishop c5. So if I trade everything king e6, that's the same line I was looking at before. It's probably some sort of theory, I'm guessing. Could play knight a4, maybe. Knight a4, just bishop back, though. You know what? Okay, I'm going to go... Knight a4, bishop back, b3 is what I was thinking, but he gets his rook into the c2 square then. Hmm. I know this is bad to have to think already. Okay, let's play h3 again. Probably rook d8 is coming, just as it was in the previous one. d4, okay. A little bit of a refinement. I thought he played rook d8 last time. Maybe I'm wrong. Bring this out. Yeah, rook d8, and now that's when I traded and played knight d5. That's how that went last time. Okay, maybe e3 this time around. Though I'm not optimistic that it really gives anything. King e8 is the problem. This is just a position that's very specific, and maybe I'm wrong for wandering into it again. Okay, I'm gonna do this again, though. Okay, let's play knight e4 this time. Attack that bishop. Last time I tried knight d5, it didn't seem to work out so well, so we'll do it this way. Now let's go e3. Attack the center. Knight back, because he's pinned. King e8, trade, he can take, so he'll have maybe a weak e-pawn, but otherwise his position looks pretty strong. 210 to 345. I think king e8 take, and then take with a rook is maybe strongest here. That's the way it looks to me. Okay, I gotta take. He's gonna take with the pawn. Interesting decision. Okay, let's go knight b5. Good chance he plays bishop c5. Yep, as he's just did. But still, I think this was necessary. b4, maybe? Let's try it. b4 take, knight takes is my plan. If bishop a6, or bishop b6 rather, I think a4 is what I can do. Trying for a5. This might not be anything more than a draw, if there's a bunch of exchanges, but we'll find out. You could play bishop c4 here. He's going to try it. Bishop f1, there's d3. Okay, but at least I can play knight a3 then. Oh, can I make marks here? Oh, that's cool. Maybe he can trade and then play a6 is one idea. Okay, he's going to do it this way. So I thought I could play this move. Trying to win his d-pawn. That's the plan here. So we'll take this guy. Knight b5 or bishop b5? Probably this. Quite a drawish position. I'm just going to defend my weakness on f2. Let's bring this back, actually. Yeah, very dry position. Opposite color bishops. Let's bring our king up. I mean, arguably, I might be a little bit worse here, but I don't think it's much. And maybe he's a little bit worse in view of the structure. I'm not sure. Yeah, he's just going to get rid of that pawn. I think that's smart. Okay, I have an extra pawn, though. At least I can continue for a little while. Maybe go after c4, or f7, rather. And if I take... I don't want him to get that outside pass pawn. Okay, so I can win the h-pawn at least. 44 seconds to his minute 40. See if what you guys were saying about Jan and his potential weakness in the endgame is true. Who knows? I mean, the guy's a GM, so I mean, he's not weak in any aspect, most likely. See, the thing is, to keep any winning chances here, I got to keep pieces on the board, but that's pretty tough. And I'm low on time. I'm actually going to offer a draw if he wants it. Yeah, I think I could try to push that, but given the amount of time I had, it might be a stupid proposition. So I'm just going to take the half point and we'll continue playing. So the downside is that puts him within a point of winning the whole match. So it's now 3-4. And yeah, if he gets one more victory, he wins. So I got to stop him in this next game with black. That's imperative. Okay, so let's take his challenge whenever it becomes available. All right. So 3-4 in Jan's favor. And here we go. Decisive game. All right, I'm sticking with g6. I just got to play quicker. That's important. So got to play faster. Okay, let's play this system again. If he's going to go knight bd2. Bring the knight out to d7 once more. And I think I was playing queen c7 here, wasn't I? I think I was. Or is it e5 right away? Might have been e5 right away. Yeah, let's do that. Okay, we'll take. Hard-fought match. All these games have been competitive pretty much. My worst game has been that second game of the match where he crushed me in a Benko. I didn't have much chance in that one. He just handily outplayed me. But other than that, I think these games have been very close. Okay, let's just continue developing. He's encroaching on my queen side. Let's play the rook here this time. I'm just going to ignore his queenside expansion for the moment. So knight f8, knight c4 is possible. Okay, now I think I'm going to play this move. Yeah, then maybe look for b5 if we get a chance. I don't want that knight settling on c4. Much like the last game, I think if he puts the knight in there, I got to be willing to kick it out right away. Full concentration. I know I'm not looking at the chat right now, but I really want to win this game, or at least draw this game, guys. Bishop c4. Rather refined. Okay, let's just maneuver. I think he might be trying to go for knight g5. Some sort of idea with that, so I need to prepare knight e6 as a reply. Mm-hmm. So if I play bishop e6, I'm going to get hit on e5, so I can't do that immediately. I could play bishop g4 and try to trade my light square bishop for his knight, but do I really want to do that? Probably not. Okay, let's just play a safety move here. Control the g5 square. Maybe I'll have to play knight h5 and then bishop e6. That might be necessary. Because otherwise, I don't see how to successfully play bishop e6. Does that move do anything? I don't think so. Just develop. He might end up playing g3 as a way to stop my knight from coming into f4. Probably he will now, if he's going to. Okay, let's bring this over with tempo. Let's play b6. He was threatening a7, so we gotta take a measure against that. Maybe c5 now. Yeah, let's do this. I want to try to get control of the d4 square. That's my thinking with this move. It's pretty aggressive, but I'm going for the gusto here. I'm going for the Gustafsson. Okay, let's take with a pawn. So if I can sink the knight into d4, I'm happy, but it's going to be anyone's guess how this will shake out, like the tension in the center. D5 is weak too. I'm just glad that he doesn't have a knight in range of d5. If he could jump a knight in there immediately, he might be in decent shape. Okay, so rook comes in. C4? Yeah, I think c4. E5 is under attack as well, but this should be all right. If knight d2, maybe queen b7, although that might drop c4. Knight d2, yeah, this puts me to a tough decision now. I think I'm going to take and then play knight g5 and try to get at h3. And again, I'm trying to move quicker, making a conscious effort to move faster here. My knight on h5 is way out of play, though, at the moment. Need to get that back in the game. f5, g5 is hanging. Let's go here and attack this pawn. And also defend g5. A queen d7 might have been good there. Queen d7 would have defended both. But this also could be good. We'll see. So he just takes. We gotta take. It's an odd-looking knight maneuver. Where's that knight going? Okay, I'm just gonna come here, because I don't really understand his last move. Now he wants out through d7. Or d5. Let's play e4. Let's take this way. c2 is hanging. This is my thinking. Gotta go for that. He can give a check, but does it matter? You can just take that. Didn't see that. Rook e5, not possible. Knight takes g3, not working. Hmm. Okay, I'm going to play a little safety on the diagonal here. Okay, let's come here. Now I'm down on time a little bit. This is an equal endgame, though. Level endgame. Let's get this back in the action. Just gonna look for a swap. Yeah, not a whole lot to do here for either side. Again, I'm gonna offer him a draw. He didn't take it, though. Could it be possible that I'd be a little bit better here? It'd be pretty extreme for me to win this, but maybe I'll try. There, king there. Nah, I'm gonna just offer him a draw. All right. I was wondering if I could play king g4, but I think that would be exceedingly risky. Because he could always play rook a3 if he needed to. Again, with the amount of time I had, I think it's best to just take the half point and fight on here. So, 3.5, 4.5. Now I'm in a must-win situation. I've got to win the game. Yeah, this is just a absolute needed victory in this next game. So, all right. Let's play this one. And I am white. Okay, so I'm going to stick with what I've been doing, but I'm going to try to play it in a slightly different way. I'm not going to go down the same road if I can avoid it. So let's play an early c4 and see how he responds. We're going to play a Benko Gambit in reverse is what we're going to do in this must-win game. So take here. Let's play this. He might do the same thing that he did with white in the other game. It's very possible. All right, take that guy. Let's go here. And maybe I'm gonna do this plan. This is an interesting little plan. And bring the queen over to b3, try to pressure b7 that way. I'm trying to stop him from going e4 is the idea with this sort of setup. Okay, so he plays the queen there. I think knight here is all right. Again, he could play bishop g4 if he wants to try to win a tempo attacking this pawn. Probably I'll go rook e1 in that case. Yeah, let's just play this to defend the pawn. I know going down a pawn in a must-win game is rather foolish, but I'm trying. Trying to do my best here. Okay, maybe e3. Maybe we want to play e3 now and attempt to attack in the center. I think this is a decent time to do it when his rooks have already been committed to this side of the board. So let's go for it. He takes. All right. So take with the rook or the knight? Probably the rook. Because I want to keep d4 covered. His king is on the same diagonal as this pawn, so maybe I can go like queen c3, rook e1, etc. Queen in, okay. Queen c3, maybe? Yeah, try to attack this guy. If knight d4, I'm thinking knight b3. Although that leads to more exchanges. I have rook a5 here. Rook a5. He could play b5 then. And it gets wacko. Maybe not in my favor. Critical moment here. Rook a5, b5, huh? F4 is too wild. Maybe rook E1? Yeah, let's do this and attack this pawn. I need pressure on that pawn. I was thinking about doing it with rook a5, but that b5 move threw me off. So we're going to do it this way. If he takes c2, I wonder if I can just take e5. Or is that too much material? It might be too much material. Well, maybe not. I don't know. It's hard to say. So knight b3 now or something else? Yeah, let's play knight b3. b5 could be played. He does play it. Okay, let's go queen c3 and try to attack e5. I know he can play b4 here, but I'm going to go all out trying to attack this pawn. That's my probably best chance of trying to get a decisive result this game. I think the conservative decision for him would just be to take on c4 like that, yeah. Okay, let's take back. Thing is, I'm kind of just down a pawn here at the moment. Let's defend that weak c4 pawn. Ah, he has knight d5 now. Knight d5 is possible. Nice shot. I hope he doesn't see that. He saw it. Okay, if I take e5, he takes c3, I take here. Could that somehow be working out for me? I guess it does. In a weird way. It's a pretty odd operation, but it actually works. I think. That's bizarre. Ah, no, we're losing a piece. Yeah, his bishop covers c8 at the end. Yeah, so all he's got to do is play rook takes f1. Yeah, nicely done. Yep, that's it. All right, I resign. So that is your match. Jan Gustafsson takes it. Yeah, 5.5, 3.5. Congratulations to him. That was pretty hard fought. This last game didn't go nearly as well as I thought it would go, or hoped it would go, I should say. I just didn't get anything going in the middle game, playing this Benko in reverse. I thought I chose a good moment to play e3 and try to attack in the center and maybe gain some counterplay, but... yeah, it didn't really lead to anything. Probably if I'm going to have something, it's like right around here after rook AE1 or before rook AE1. But the thing is, despite my best attempts, there was no way to truly pressure D4 and E5 in the way I wanted. Like rook A5 wasn't working because he could play B5. And he took over the initiative and found that nice tactical move, knight D5 in the end. It was a well-played game by Jan to round things up here. If I don't play rook takes E5, he's just going to take my rook on e3 after I move my queen, and I'll just be down in exchange. So, just talking to Jan in Skype here real quick. So, my assessment of this match, it was competitive, definitely. I think his better understanding of openings really showed, because in pretty much every game out of the opening, I was either worse or maybe equal in some of them. I didn't really get much from the opening phase of the game, which when you're comparing like a 2450 like me to a 2600 plus like Jan, that's expected. I felt like when we actually did get into some fighting positions, there were chances for both sides. The clock was a persistent problem for me. He definitely had me on the clock, which I think was related a lot to the openings, especially if you recall those two games with white, where we went into that line where I had that pressure on d5, but I spent a lot of time in the very first game and also the later game trying to figure out what to do there, and I think I came away with two draws. Or no, I flagged him in the very first game, and I came away with a draw another game. That first flag was pretty vicious and maybe undeserved, though. So, yes, to recap, we lose the match 3.5 to 5.5, but very entertaining one, and I think there was some fighting chess here. What do you guys think? Did I do all right? Did I live up to the Team Scandi name? Yes, true, Torgear. My 1500 rating on Chess 24 doesn't measure up to Jan's 2738. So, yeah, Ramakrishna, my clock management was not good. He came in and he just kind of fired off those opening moves rapidly, and Jan's actually telling me where maybe I could have improved. He said knight a4 instead of h3 in that reversed Grünfeld is very unpleasant. I'm going to ask him real quick what he means by that, because I think he's saying it's unpleasant for black. This page has become unresponsive. Let's wait for a moment here. Okay. He says Vallejo specializes in that line, but it's mainly a bluff. Yeah, that's not something I was aware of. So he's saying that that one variation... Yeah, that reverse Grünfeld that I was just talking about a moment ago is not especially good for black. I kind of felt that way, but I just couldn't figure it out in a blitz game. It's very difficult. Thank you, Vano. I'm glad you still thought it was fire. We didn't see a Scandinavian because Jan doesn't play e4. He never opened with e4. So, he told me he's going to keep his slob prep for our next match. So that sounds like we'll probably have a rematch, which if Jan is open to it, I'd love to do a rematch at some stage. I wonder if Jan plays Bullet too. It'd be fun to play him in some Bullet games. But maybe we'll save that for next time. I'm going to stick around here a little bit and talk to you guys and maybe even play a couple more games. So... we've got 835 people watching. That's almost a record. I was saying that last stream we had, I think, close to 850 at one stage. And compared to some of the earlier streams I did, that sort of turnout is incredible, because I think some of my earlier streams had maybe 200 or 300, which is still quite good. But basically within the span of a few months, the stream viewership has doubled or maybe even tripled in compared to some of the very early ones. Obviously, playing big guys like Jan from Chess24 is going to help that, but that's just amazing to me that so many of you guys are willing to watch someone just stream chess online. And I think that shows the potential that like streaming on YouTube and Twitch has. Crimson, I lost the match 3.5 to 5.5. Yeah. So, what kind of questions do you guys have? I'm willing to take questions here now that the match is over. So, let's see if I can answer some stuff. You guys have all been very patient. Say something about Chessable. Okay, so Chessable, which is the venture that I co-founded, is launching on Monday, this coming Monday, February 22nd. So, at that time, you'll have access to the site. You can get a membership. There's free and paid content on Chessable, so everyone can get a free membership, and we'll also have paid services available too. So I'm very excited for that, and I'll be working hard on it the next few days just leading up to the launch and stuff. I'll almost certainly publish a video very soon talking more about that and introducing you guys to the site. So stay tuned for that. David, if Starbucks wanted to sponsor me, I would gladly let them do that. If a multinational corporation like Starbucks wants to get on the Finns train, they know where to find me. Oh, by the way, Colin, if you are watching, Colin yesterday said in my announcement video that he was very happy that he was unemployed, because that means he had no conflicts in watching the match. And I told him I was going to make him a mod today, but I haven't seen him in the chat. So, Colin, if you're watching this, I'm sorry for not modding you up. I just haven't seen you in the chat. Devin, I'm probably going to stick to chess 24 for now. It's just too hard to switch the streams and get like a different site up there. I've already got my stream layout all set here. So I might play a little bit or just answer some questions for you guys. Why is the Scandinavian a good opening? Well, the Scandinavian actually has a reputation as a dubious opening, but I think it's all right. I think it's perfectly playable. And I would say for 99.9% of chess players, it's a completely valid opening. The nice thing about the Scandinavian is that you know, and maybe I can even go back on this board and show it. So if you're black, how do I flip the board here? This will just be convenient because I can demonstrate stuff on this board. So one of the beautiful things of the Scandinavian is, you know, if you play d5, there's a great chance that white's going to capture the pawn because no other white move is particularly good. So after e takes d5, whether you play knight f6 here or queen takes d5, you pretty much know, hey, I'm going to get this position the vast majority of the time. Moreover, like 90% of people play knight c3 here. And whether you play queen a5 or queen d8 or queen d6, all of these are valid moves. You can be pretty certain that you're going to get this position most of the time. So there's this convenience factor. It really cuts down on the number of sidelines that you have to have knowledge of. And for a player who's just an amateur especially, that takes away so much stress when designing your opening repertoire. If you just know that you're going to get a certain setup most of the time, and you've probably played way more games than your opponent in that setup, hey, what's not to like about that? You do move the queen around sometimes, especially with these queen takes d5 lines on move 2, but black has a solid setup. You're usually going to play knight f6, pawn c6. After you develop the light square bishop out to f5 or g4, you can play e6, and you build a light square restriction structure. So, two biggest advantages of the Scandinavian in my mind are the predictability of it and the schemes that you can employ from that point forward are pretty easy to learn. I think most people can pick them up pretty quickly. Oh, we have I'm a Dirty Cheater in the chat. Is the Scandinavian repertoire free? You know what I'm going to do? I'm actually going to make a free Scandinavian repertoire and a paid version of it. Okay, so there's one that will cost you a little bit. Nothing like exorbitant. I'm not going to fleece you guys. But there will be a free version as well, so people can still kind of get the gist of the repertoire without having to pay if they don't want to. I watched your video from the Wesley So Lee Chess Tournament, and you were wondering what exactly Chess at 3 is. They are a company focusing on, I think it's like early childhood chess. I thought Chess at 3 was a reference to time, like chess at 3 o'clock p.m. or something. I didn't do my research before playing that tournament. I just saw, hosted by Chess at 3. But Chess at 3 is apparently like an early childhood chess education organization, which is very cool. If you can learn at chess at 3 years old, you're way ahead of the game. Carlsen played the Scandi and won recently. Yes, very true. He played it against Fabiano Caruana and won a key game, actually. That's the biggest example of a Scandinavian game, a Scandinavian game at the very top level. Do you know Wesley So personally? Have you played him much? I do know Wesley personally. I see him around here in Minnesota. We also play for the same U.S. Chess League team. Very nice guy. I wouldn't say I hang out with him like very often, but I'm friendly with him. No issues whatsoever. I'll try to avoid taking more Scandinavian questions for those of you who are sick of the Scandinavian. John, a strange question. How can someone win at a chess game? I am pondering this on the last few days, I assume you mean. Well, you win by checkmate, Aris. And you outplay your opponent. You outcalculate them. You find something that they didn't find. You take their hanging pieces if they're offered to you. And eventually you win by checkmate if they refuse to resign. Oh, thank you, Arturo. Glad to hear you've been improving your play and watching my videos. Let's see who else here. How can I find information about your lessons? How much are they roughly? I'm not going to say what my rate is. I just prefer to keep that private. But if you're interested in lessons, you can email me. I'm currently taking a bit of a lesson hiatus because I've been working on Chessable quite a bit. And honestly, since I've started this YouTube channel, especially in the last few months, I've got so many lesson requests, it's impossible for me to teach everyone. So if you email me about lessons, You're probably going to end up on my waiting list. It's just the reality of it. But if you're interested, feel free to email me. And I do teach via Skype, yes. John, how do you remember your repertoire? Well, Chessable is a site that has been helping me in that regard, because on Chessable, you can enter your lines in, and our algorithm will play the moves back at you and help you memorize them. So I've been using that with some of my own repertoires. Also, there's other ways to do it. You can study games in the opening that you play. So you can look up master games and see what grandmasters do in the same opening. And if you study enough of those games, eventually these ideas, if not the move orders, will become ingrained in your head. And that goes a long way in helping you over the board. I don't charge $350 an hour. That would be a little much. Are you married? No, I am not. I am not married. Any good tips on learning to use coordinates? Chess.com and LeeChess both have a coordinates trainer. So you can feel free to use that, where it gives you a square and there's a blank chessboard and you have to click on the square that it is displaying. So it'll pop out like A4 and you have to find that square. Also, playing blindfold chess is a really good way to improve your knowledge of the coordinates. I think anyone of reasonable intelligence can learn the coordinates pretty fast. And once you start using them in your chess parlance, just like I do when I'm talking about a game, I'll say like knight E4, bishop G4, stuff like that. You'll learn it very quickly. What music do you listen to? I like to listen to classic rock. I listen to a little bit of everything, but classic rock is my favorite. John, final thoughts about this match with Jan. What was wrong? The openings? I would say his opening knowledge was on display, definitely, and my clock management wasn't so good. Yeah, I was down on time virtually every game, which I think is directly related to the openings. I mean, I think you guys saw like one of the biggest differences between a 2600 and a 2450. Like, I feel like I can compete with him. I mean, he's still better than me in every phase of chess, but I can compete with him if I get out of the opening with equal time. But the openings matter a lot in chess, and it's important to study. And I'm trying to get better at my openings. It's just I don't have the knowledge that a 26 FIDE player has. So that was apparent here. Will you start streaming on Twitch? Probably not anytime soon, if at all, because I like YouTube. I like the setup that we have going here. I'm quite comfortable on YouTube. I know there's some problems with German viewers. I don't know if this is still the case. I believe it is, but German people have trouble viewing streams on YouTube because of some copyright involving music streaming or something like that. So I've thought about switching to Twitch, but it's likely I won't. If I do, I'll tell you guys about it. When is your next OTB tournament? You know, I was supposed to play the Minnesota Open this past weekend, but I've been very busy with work, especially with Chessable about to launch in a few days, so I had to skip it. Just a piece of advice for you who play over-the-board tournaments. It's very important to play when you have a clear head, and every time I've tried to play a tournament where I have a ton of other obligations or one major project like hanging over my head, I almost always do poorly. So if you're going to carve out the time to play like a weekend tournament or something over the board, try to clear your schedule. Try to go in with a free mind, let's say, and be ready to create something on the board and invest your entire energy into that game and that tournament that you're playing. So that's why I didn't play this past weekend. As far as upcoming tournaments, no real plans. I might play some local stuff, but I'm going to take it easy for a couple months. Just play online, play matches, do my videos, teach, and see where I'm at in a few months. It's such an investment of time and energy and money to go play GM Norm tournaments that I always go back and forth about whether I want to do it. I'm also quite content just doing what I'm doing, and I don't need to become a GM to be fulfilled. So, how helpful would a coach be for a Class A or B player? Pretty helpful. Yeah, I mean, a coach can just streamline everything for you, but if you're Class A or B, they can make things a lot easier. They can point out things, especially in regards to your opening repertoire or your middle game play, probably your endings too, in pretty much every phase of the game, that you might figure out on your own, but it would take you a lot longer. And going from class A or B up to, let's say, 2200 can often be tweaking just little things in your repertoire, firming up some lines, having a better understanding of typical middle games you get. And I think a good coach can really help you with that. Will you play a match against Nakamura on chess.com? I would love to. I haven't had that opportunity, but I would love to do that. That would be amazing. I cannot play the Minnesota Closed, Anton. I didn't play the Minnesota Open, so I didn't have a chance to qualify for the Closed. You recommended playing King's Pawn and Queen's Pawn for beginners. Sorry, that question went way too fast. Something about Queen's Gambit declined. Adnan, I might play a couple games. We'll see. Just going to take a few more questions here. John, can you just make videos for us all day? I wish. I wish, Lili. Sticks, yes, I want to continue the Chess Fundamentals series. So when I get up the motivation and the time to make them, I will continue that series for sure. I got great feedback on the last one on Pawn Play. So thank you to those who have watched and commented about that. I'd like to do a deathmatch for chess.com as well. You know, Danny has talked to me about that in the past. It's just when deathmatches were getting started on chess.com, I told him, like, yeah, let me know in the future. And I think they had so much interest in these deathmatches that there was just a constant stream of people wanting to play them. So I never, like, asked Danny if I could play, but I'm pretty sure if I really wanted to, I could arrange one with him or against someone else too. I mean, Danny and I basically play death matches all the time with Chess Rivals, so we've got that going. 100% Berserk Hyper Bullet. Oh, God. That sounds like some form of torture. 15 seconds on my clock. I'm going to leave that to Eric Hansen and the Chess Bras. Maybe I'll do that for fun sometime, though, but I'm just not as fast as I would like to be. What happened with the rematch with Hushinbet? Yeah, Nicholas and I have been talking. I think we're going to try to do that rematch maybe in the next month or so. That would be ideal. Boy, these questions are going fast. Please play a game on Chess 24 now. What's John's favorite board game? Chess, of course. No doubt about that. I like Risk as well. Like when I'm playing with friends and stuff, Risk is a really fun one in my opinion. What do you think about the Nimzowitsch defense? E4 knight c6, do you mean? Or the Nimzo Indian? E4 knight c6, I think it has some independent value, but if white plays knight f3 on move 2, I don't think black gets much. Just a transposition to other openings. John, do you have other family members that play chess professionally? No. I'm the only one in my family who plays chess. I have a younger brother, David. Hello, David, if you're watching this. I doubt you are. You're probably at work. And he is pretty good, and he actually won a tournament one time, but he doesn't have much interest in chess. He quit playing pretty young. Ah, glad to hear you like the Q&A, Drew. How can I learn to play blindfold? Just got to try it. Jump in. Even if you can play just like 5 moves in your head without the board getting muddy, that's still okay. Try it and keep track of how many moves you can see in your head. Next time, try for 6 moves. See if you can visualize 6 moves. What's your favorite response to e4 that isn't d5? Good question, Tony. I'm fascinated by the Sicilian. I would really like to play the Sicilian well, like a classical, a dragon, a knight orf. I'd love to play all of those with some proficiency. I play the Khan from time to time. That's probably my strongest Sicilian. But I feel like I didn't get on the Sicilian train early enough. I didn't play it much at all for my early chess career, and it's hard to learn now. Everything takes time, and learning an opening at IM or GM level is incredibly time-consuming. But I love Sicilian games. What criteria should you seek when considering a chess coach? Online versus local? Is title important? And how do I determine their playing style? I think online lessons for better players are a very good idea because they're faster. You can cover a lot more material with online lessons. Just the time that you save not having to physically set up the board is huge. And being able to jump right to a position, that saves so much time. You should try to find someone whose style you admire. And if you have seen an example of their teaching, whether it's like in YouTube videos or something like that, and you think you would match up well stylistically and also just personality-wise with them, do that. You want someone who also is going to push you. Like, I give my students homework in between lessons, and that's a good way to keep them accountable. So I would say someone who's going to kind of look after your interests and is also available for questions is a nice thing to have. So teachers do various things. Like, of course, you don't want to bother a teacher too much. You don't want to, like, bombard them with questions outside of the lesson time. But I think it's important for a teacher to be accessible. So if you have a certain question once in a while, that it can be answered. I think title is not so important. It depends on your level. I mean, not all title players make good coaches. I've seen some really strong players that are just terrible coaches, to be honest. And vice versa, I've seen some weaker players who are fantastic coaches. So it really depends. I mean, if someone's like 1500, I mean, maybe the maximum that they can effectively coach is like a 1200 rated player or lower, but they might be really good at doing that. So I would say a title is not important. If you're higher rated, you should probably seek out a title coach and try to find a good one. But it's just one criteria. John, what do you bench? I haven't benched for the longest time because my current gym doesn't actually have a bench, strangely enough. I have no idea what I could bench. I hope I can still bench more than my body weight. I'm almost certain I can. I'm going to say maybe 175. I'm not that strong, but I do, like, work out a little bit. And I weigh, like, 160. So I'm going to say 175 to be safe. What's your favorite video game? I can tell you what my favorite computer games are. Video games, I honestly haven't played very much. I'll go old school and I'll say GoldenEye for N64. I used to play N64 all the time. So I like Mario Kart and GoldenEye. I haven't played on any of the new consoles, though, like, in years, so I wouldn't be able to say. I do not have a coach, Torgear. I do not. Do you have an opinion on the Sicilian O'Kelly variation, which is, so if we go back here, the O'Kelly variation is black playing a6 on move 2 like this, which is a tricky transpositional move, because if white plays d4, as they typically do in open Sicilian, then black's idea is to go here. And if e5, there's queen a5 check, forking the king and the pawn. If knight c3, then I believe e5 is good with bishop b4 to come soon, if I'm remembering my theory properly. So the O'Kelly variation is, like, you can almost consider it like an accelerated Nydorf. But if white plays c4 or knight c3, or I think c3 is also a good move, I think the O'Kelly doesn't have much value to offer. So I don't want to say it's a trap opening, but it's most effective if white plays d4 on move 3 just automatically, but a good player will play a different move to avoid that aforementioned variation. I don't follow MMA, Tomek. I follow boxing, but not MMA too much. I mean, I know some of the big MMA fighters, but I do not. No, my brother is not part of Chessable. My brother works for the Red Cross in DC. He's a Washington, D.C. guy. He is far removed from chess now at this stage in his life. I do love Age of Empires. I loved that game when I was younger. Age of Empires, Counter-Strike. I used to play those games all the time. Yep, King Oliver. I have a couple videos out in Crazy House. I played Danny in Crazy House, our last chess rivals. We had a mini Crazy House match. John, what is your favorite non-chess channel? You guys should look up Maximus Thor. Maximus Thor. Weirdest and most entertaining videos ever. I'm not going to say much more. They have about 50 or 60,000 subscribers. You can just go binge watch their videos. That's my favorite non-chess channel. Are you a Star Wars fan? Mildly. I've seen all the Star Wars movies, but I'm not browsing Star Wars forums and getting too hyped about the new movies coming out and stuff. What size hat do you wear? I don't know. I'm not sure. Yes, a Frenchman. I have traveled to Europe to play. I played in Reykjavik, Iceland. I played in London, England. I've also been to Slovenia to coach at the World Youth Chess Championships. I haven't done, like, a tour of London, either for pleasure or for tournaments. I would like to do that sometime. Have you ever seen Chess Network's face? No. Yeah. I don't think he ever shows himself on camera. Sticks, that's a good question. Are you bringing in expertise for other openings at Chessable? That's our hope, that if people like the site, that they will add content, and also people will be able to add repertoires that they can profit from. If it's a very good repertoire and they want to make it for sale, then they can do that. And Tony, we'd love to have Tony make a Sicilian repertoire. Obviously, the standard for getting a repertoire approved on Chessable and trying to make a profit on it, trying to sell it, will be higher, and we'll have to review it and make sure there's no copyright violations and stuff like that. But that's one of the ideas of Chessables. That'll be kind of an app store where you can purchase repertoires that knowledgeable players have created. And there'll also be free repertoires too. What's your favorite chess player of all time? I'm a big Karpov and Kramnik guy. I like those guys a lot. I would say it's a tie between them. I've never played Shogi, Jackson. I sort of know the rules, but never played a complete game of Shogi. John, would you recommend the Nimzo Queens Indian to 1400 to 1500 level? Honestly, no. I think the Nimzo complex is theoretically very strong. But would I recommend it to a player at that level? Probably not. Because the thing about that, and I mentioned this before, you have to know so many different pawn structures to successfully play the Nimzo complex. I think it's a daunting task for lower rated players. You can do it, but I think you're going to have better results with more straightforward defenses to d4. So I wouldn't recommend it to most players below 2,000 even. Z Steven, yes, the match is over, but I will be posting the archive version of this shortly afterwards. Will there be an Android app for Chessable? There will be no app for Chessable immediately. We're just releasing the web-based version. But if there's sufficient interest and the site is successful, because we have no idea how the site's going to go, we think people will like it, but everything is up in the air. It really depends how much interest there is in Chessable. If there is interest, then we can justify spending more money and time on making an app available. This is a true startup. It's just me and my co-founder, David. And I'm like the chess side of the equation, and he's the programming side. It's just us two, and we've been fortunate not to have to invest too much of our own money, but we have invested a lot of time. So, hope that answers your question. Will you be resident IM in St. Louis? If the St. Louis Chess Club wants me to, that would be an interesting proposition. I'd love to go down there and make some lectures, some Mike Kummer style lectures. Just kidding. What's the weirdest opening you've played? Probably the Xinji Indian. Yeah, the Xinji Indian, which you guys have seen me play on stream. It just produces some bizarre positions. Whoops, that's not the right move. And actually, I was willing to play it against Jan if he wanted to go into it today. So the Xinji Indian is in this position playing bishop takes c3 and then going f5. Is the way I like to play it, controlling the e4 square. This just produces this like bizarre pawn structure where black has surrendered the pair of bishops, surrendered this typically good dark square bishop on the long diagonal, but they can try to play against these pawns like with queen a5 and attacking c4 and c3 pretty vigorously. So this opening is not 100% sound for black, but it's a lot of fun. So that's why I continue to play it, especially online. What will be the future of your channel? Do you feel it's going well? Any new features coming up? Yes, I'm happy with the way the channel's been going. It's been growing rapidly in the past few months. It's a lot of work posting videos every day, and I definitely continue to do so for the foreseeable future. I don't know with what volume I'll be able to crank out videos over the coming years, let's say, but I want to keep building my channel and really see where it goes. And I hope to introduce more diverse content as well. I think the same cycle of bullet, blitz, and standard is instructive, and I know people like it day to day, but probably at some stage I'll move away from that a little bit and start trying to mix up my content more. And if that means posting slightly less, I may do that just to throw you guys some new content, because there are really a lot of chess YouTubers out there, and I think in the coming years you'll see even more. And a lot of people just do like blitz with commentary, bullet with commentary. And I feel like there's other videos that can be made, and I want to explore that at some point in the near future. Not that it isn't interesting to watch someone play Bullet or Blitz or Standard, especially with commentary, but if everyone is doing the same type of video, I think that gets boring for the viewer. Will we see a match between you and Feingold? If Ben was still doing videos and streaming online, I'd love to play him. I think he shut down his channel, though. When you say not technically sound, is that as untechnically sound as the Budapest Gambit? It might be in that same territory. The Budapest Gambit and the Jinji Indian. I would say Budapest Gambit might even have a slightly better reputation than the Jinji Indian. Do you have a job outside chess? Nope, I do not. I have a business degree and I was in law school for a while, but I've been doing chess full time for the past about 5 years. The vast majority of that has been coaching. Only lately have I got into doing different things like this YouTube channel in the past year and a half, Chessable, stuff like that. But coaching is still my main thing. I really like to teach. John, what do you think is the difference between an IM and a GM? Well, a GM just does everything a little bit better than an IM. I would say knowledge of openings and the associated middle games is a huge difference. So if I had to single out one distinguishing factor between those two titles, that would be it. Better knowledge of openings and middle games. I don't think GMs necessarily calculate that much better than IMs. There's a lot of IMs who can keep up with GMs in the calculation and the tactics department. But like what you saw here, the difference between me and Jan, I think is very typical of what you'd find. The difference between a GM and IM. Danny and I should play a standard game. That's right, Aaron. That would be a good idea. Now that you're on Chess 24, could you play GM Hushinbet? Yeah, like I said earlier, we're thinking about playing another match. He's been asking me. I'm just kind of busy at the moment, so he and I will play a rematch, though. Guaranteed. John, your rating has remained in the same range for the last 5 years. How have you improved as a player? On paper, my rating has stayed the same, although I think I have gotten better over the last few years. Especially in the past year and a half since I've had this channel, I think I have improved a lot. The thing about FIDE ratings, especially here in the US, I think a lot of the US players are a little underrated, especially our junior players. We've got a lot of underrated junior players around here. So, I mean, yes, I'm not playing at a 2500 level, and I wish my rating had increased over the past half decade, but I've also done a lot of stuff non-tournament related. Teaching a lot. Tournaments has not been my focus, hardly ever in chess, honestly. I was a lot more active when I was younger, like in high school, and I didn't have as many obligations and things like that. And I'd love to pack up and just play tournaments, but when you get to be an adult, it's much harder. And I'm a single guy, and you know, I have nothing holding me down. I've got disposable income, but even still, it's like I would have to, everything I'm doing in chess and even outside of chess, just my hobbies and things like that, has to grind to a halt if I want to pursue GM. And given that you don't really get anything when you become a GM, no one like hands you a check for like $100,000 or something. It's just a personal goal, and you get more respect in the chess community, maybe some additional opportunities. But from a purely objective standpoint, it's probably not worth it for most IMs to make the sacrifice to try to become a GM. So that's kind of what I'm grappling with right now. If I'm ever going to do it, it's going to be purely a personal thing, and I'll probably throw myself into it 100%. What is your opinion on the Nidorf? Great opening. One of the best openings in chess, period. It's got a tremendous reputation. Can you play a match against Hutch? Yes, I am in contact with Hutch, actually. That might happen in the future. Who is your choice to win the candidates tourney? So the candidates coming up very soon. I pick Nakamura. I think he's going to get the job done. Just going to go out on the limb. Does it take some getting used to when playing against teenage IMs and even GMs? Well, young players tend to have a lot of energy, and they're usually pretty up-to-date in openings. And I think you're noticing that even more with players born in, like, let's say the mid-1990s and even earlier. You know, I play opponents now who were born in the 2000s. It's crazy. And the influence of all these resources they have at their fingertips, and especially just the huge increase in chess theory and knowledge of theory you've seen in the past like 10 years or so. It's so pronounced, especially among the young players. So it's tough to play them because they calculate well and they're pretty booked up most of the time. And a lot of times they're just underrated, period. Might take a couple more questions. I'm going to avoid the questions that can only incite criticism or controversy, like what are your political views? Yeah, I'm not going to get into that much here. We're not going to talk about politics or religion. I consider this channel to be like things you don't discuss on a first date too, you know, because why get into those sort of topics? There'll just be people arguing in the chat. For how long do you think Carlsen will dominate the chess world? Very tough to say. I think he can do it for the next 5 to 10 years. I mean, 10 years might be an upper bound. I don't know if he'll have the motivation to try to be the best, but certainly for the next 5, I think he's got the skill set and the longevity to do it. He's been crushing the major tournaments right now, but also there's a lot of effort that goes into a title defense. And all it takes is for some elite player to have a good run against him in a world championship match and bye-bye Magnus from the world championship. So I'd say like, yeah, I mean, probably 5 years is a safe bet. If he gets to 10, I think that would be an incredible achievement in this day and age. If he can stay world champion for 10 years, he would go down as the best player in history, in my opinion, given how many good players there are out these days. It's not easy to be the top of the world. I mean, compared to like 30 years ago, it's not even close. I know it's not our first date, Coach Amur. That was just a metaphor, an analogy. Oh, hello, Colin. Yeah, I was going to mod you up, Colin. In fact, let me see if I can do that right now. I know it's late in the stream. Let's see if I can... How do I do this? Put user in a timeout. Well, I'm not going to do that. Set user as moderator. All right, there you go, sir. Just remember, heavy is the head that wears the crown, so use your power wisely. Do you recommend Sicilian openings for beginners? Yeah, the Sicilian is a good opening, and you can play it even at a beginning stage of your chess career. Absolutely. John, studying openings or games better for intermediate players? I'd say a little of both. When you're an intermediate player, let's say around 1500, I think it makes sense to start working on your openings a bit more, but I think you shouldn't go overboard, and studying GM games should be hand in hand with that, making sure you're putting an emphasis on learning the ideas and absorbing the knowledge of good players. Annotated games are great. Annotated games of top players are tremendous. Yeah, sorry, Flublet. The match is over. Did you vote in the Kasparov against the world? That match took place in what, like 1999 or 2000? Nope. I was just getting started in chess at that time. Well, I guess I was like maybe a 1500 rated player at that time, but I don't even think I knew about online chess at that stage. Do you think chess is becoming more popular? Seems like more people are playing these days to me. It's hard to say. I think more people are transitioning to online gaming, and chess is included in that. I do think chess is growing slightly in popularity. I haven't seen a monumental shift to back that up, but it seems to me chess is becoming more popular by the year. Maybe because it's a game that pairs well with the internet, and a lot of people are realizing that, even though chess is an ancient game. Where do you find annotated games of strong GMs? Buying a book, especially a book written by the Grandmaster in question, is your best bet. But also if you buy a big database, like Big Database or Mega Database, which are both databases I think produced by Chessbase, you can find annotated games in those too. How's it going, Matt Jensen? He said, why is Minnesota the best state for chess players? Yeah, certainly we can't step to New York or California, but we've got a nice little chess scene here. We have a very cohesive scene, and we produce good young players, and everyone in the Minnesota chess scene, with only very few exceptions, is really cool and very pleasant. We support our players. And now that we have Wesley So living in the state, I think the visibility of Minnesota chess is only increasing. Cool, Cone. Yeah, Maximus Thor is great. I love that YouTube channel. Where can I buy that hanging chess set? If you look online and just like search for demo board, demo chess board, you can probably find it on Amazon. It's pretty neat. Have you used Larry Kaufman's Komodo engine? No, I've never used Komodo, even though it's supposedly the strongest engine in the world. Seems like Komodo and Stockfish kind of go back and forth competing for that title, but no, I've never used it. When and why did you get serious about chess? I'd say I got serious in elementary school, fourth to sixth grade, right in that range. And why? Something about chess just really appealed to me. I very much enjoyed studying the game and playing it with my friends, and I wanted to get better, and I checked out books from the library. I had a tabletop chess computer that I played against with 72 levels, and I sat down and started at level 0, or level 1, whatever it was, and just worked my way up and eventually beat all 72. So there's something about the game that's always been interesting to me. And one nice thing about chess, I think, is no matter how long you've studied it and how good you get, there's always that next level, right? I mean, even for Magnus, the next level for him is to continue winning tournaments and see if he can hold on to his world championship title for many more years to come. There's always another challenge. Sorry if I'm missing questions. I know I'm missing a lot of questions here. The chat is going so fast. I'll probably take a few more and then I might play a game or two. How do you compare the achievement of getting GM title with other achievements like getting a MD, PhD, law degree? Much, much harder. Just look at the proportion of chess players and GMs. Much, much harder. And degrees like that, I mean, I don't want to say that you can easily get them because that's not true. You have to have a lot of perseverance and hard work. But if you do the right things, you will get a PhD or you'll become a doctor. You'll pass your exams. It'll happen. But in chess, you can do a lot of the right things and you still won't get to the top or you might not get to the top for a very long time. Just as an example, like scoring norms in a tournament, you can play a perfect tournament and a technicality can take a norm away from you. One of your opponents could not show up in the final round and just like that, hey, no GM norm, no IM norm, whatever. So, I mean, if you're like an absolute picture-perfect chess player, yes, you'll become a grandmaster, but it's not nearly as easy as getting an advanced degree. So that's my thought on that. What's your favorite chess piece? I think I've answered this question before. I think I said I didn't have an opinion. Yeah, I really don't. I don't have a particular favorite chess piece, I don't think. Everyone says knight because it's the most unique, but... What is your opinion about Anand's prospects and the candidates? That's very interesting. I think it's anyone's best guess how Anand's going to do. The guy is all over the map. I mean, he did terrible in Gibraltar, but he's done awesome in Zurich. It's just so hard to predict right now. I agree with Chess Explained. I was watching one of Christoph's streams maybe a week or two ago, and he said that he hopes that Anand doesn't win. He's like, yeah, Anand's a nice guy, but I hope he doesn't win the candidates. And I agree. I think another Anand versus Carlsen match would be so boring. We need some new blood in there. We need like a Geary or a Nakamura to challenge for the world championship. My feeling is Anand will not be competing for the top. I think his performances have just been a little too erratic lately. Did you read any non-chess book to help your chess, like a personal development book? Not especially, no. Chess is best learned and understood by playing and studying chess. You could maybe get some advice from like some sort of like book like the Art of War or something by Sun Tzu or some sort of, I don't know, even like philosophical or spiritual book, but it's not going to replace an actual instructive chess book. John, recently I've started to see visual artifacts where the pieces have potential moves. Does that ever happen to you? Do you know anyone else that experiences something similar? I don't know what you mean by visual artifacts. Like the pieces are somehow represented differently in your mind compared to actual pieces? That sounds like a trip. I'm curious how different chess would be when pawns take straight ahead instead of diagonally. Very different. That would completely alter the game. Opinions on Kasparov? Great player. As a person, eh. I disagree with what he says a lot. I mean, he's a very strong-willed person, let's put it that way. He became world champion because he's got a fighting will. I wouldn't be friends with him, I'll tell you that. I think he's too forceful of a personality. He might be interesting to talk to once in a while, but I like Kasparov the chess player more than Kasparov the person. Favorite non-chess book? I think my favorite non-chess book is 1984. I very much like that book. How are you at checkers? I feel like I could beat you at checkers. I'm mediocre at checkers. I'm not skilled at that game at all. I like the Beatles. Yes, in Rainbows. The Beatles are awesome. One of those timeless bands. People will be talking about them 100 years from now. Do you think you have reached your peak rating yet? No, Yvonne, I think I can get better. And I don't know what my peak is. Obviously, I'm at a later stage in my chess career. I'm 29. I'll be 30 next fall, this coming fall. And this is the point in a chess player's career where typically they're just leveling off and not getting much better, but I feel good about my game, and I feel I can reach a little higher. Yeah. John, have you seen Deadpool? No, I have not. I'd like to see that movie. I haven't seen it yet. Favorite chess square? Endre, come on. What do you think I'm gonna say? Of course, it's that beautiful d5 square. It's gotta be. What is your golf handicap? Oh God. Now it's probably like a 20. If I'm lucky. Now, probably worse than that. 20 to 30? I don't know. I used to golf a lot more, but in the past few years, I haven't golfed hardly at all. I am gonna play in a second, Lili. We just had a lot of questions, so. I used to play poker online, yes. I still like to play poker on occasion just with friends and stuff, but when online poker was big, I was playing a lot of that. Yeah. I was multi-tabling like 25 cent, 50 cent, 50 cent dollar, stuff like that. And then Black Friday happened and no more online poker in the US. Okay, let's play a few games. I think this is a good time to play a few games, and I'll probably wrap up the questions for now, but we've got some challenges here. If I see someone I know, I'm gonna play a game or two. All right. 5 minute is a little fast, or a little slow, I mean. I'm just taking a look at all these challenges. Ah, Tony wants to play. All right. I gotta play Tony because Tony is a longtime viewer of this stream, and he's the author of The Killer Sicilian. Well, what is this about? Am I black or white here? I do not understand. Oh, the board is flipped. Okay, let's play Tony with a flipped board. This could be kind of funny. So, I could flip it back, but let's see how this works out. I don't want to give away my plans to Tony, so we're gonna try to play him backwards, which could be tough with only 3 minutes on our clock. And I forgot that Tony is an expert on English as well. This reminds me of Top Gun. The quip that Goose has in there about being inverted, or actually it was Tom Cruise. Okay, I'm gonna go knight e1 and try to get my knight to c2. So I'm gonna try to go knight c2 and get the knight into e3. Tony's got quite a rating here, 2403. He's recognizing that rating mismatch too, my puny 1500 rating. Is a weird sensation playing backwards like this. All right, we're maneuvering for that d5 square. My real plan is to flag Tony. Don't tell him that, but I'm attempting to beat him on time. You want to trade those light square bishops? No trade for you. So if bishop h3, I can pull the bishop back to h1. So he might be going for some b5 business. Makes sense. What to do? All right, I'll play a4. Just stop b5 for now. Opinion on Scotland. Looks like a lovely country. I've never been to Scotland. Sean, I lost the match. 3.5. 3.5 to 5.5. But I put up a decent fight, so I'm relatively happy with the result. I'm going to jump in now, try to get my dark square bishop involved here. How many cups of coffee do you drink per day? You know, I don't drink coffee after the morning and afternoon, so never in the evening. I would say, like, my average drink, it's, like, I go to Starbucks a lot. I'd say it's, like, I mean, it's probably, like, the equivalent of 2 cups of coffee. So nothing excessive. And I drink a lot of tea. So just, like, green tea and herbal tea and stuff like that. I don't like to go huge on the caffeine. Okay, maybe bishop g5. Bishop h6 would be nifty, but it's kind of just flashy and nothing else. Yeah, let's go here. Attacking e7. Probably he'll play f6 just to boot my bishop. And then I'm going to come back to d2. One thing about the chess.com board is it's really small. I don't know how to make it bigger. You guys can't really tell on stream, but it's like, it's less than half the screen, far less than half the screen. It's probably like a quarter of my screen or less, which is one thing I don't quite like about this site. Okay, e3, I could punt the knight. Yeah, that looks all right. Kick this knight out of here, maybe go for b4 as well. Is the time ripe to play b4? Yeah, let's do it. So if he takes, I'll probably take with the bishop and try to attack d6, I'm thinking. Pawn takes or bishop takes? Probably bishop takes, so we get the pin going as well. We like that pin. Okay, let's play rook b1, maybe anticipating an open file later on. Let's bring the bishop back here. Tony's playing a little quicker. He knows he's down on time. Can't blame him for wanting to play a little faster. I'm going to try to double up on the B file, I think. Let's go here, though, because we want to avoid diagonal problems. We don't want the diagonal to come back and hurt us. Let's do this. He's got little time remaining. Now let's go here. Invade. Attack the A-pawn. Can we take it? I guess so. Okay, let's play queen over to E2 and cover. Try to cover some stuff. Drop the bishop back here. I'm going to go here. Maybe rook f1. Yeah, try to induce some trades. Bring this baby back. Bring this over. Take that guy. Are we going to flag Mr. Tony Rowe? Oh, we got the flag. It was close. Yeah, a bit of a flag there at the end. He spent a lot of time in the middle game, though. Okay, let's flip this back around. That was just an experiment. I've always wanted to do that. I've just been curious if I could actually do it competently. So it didn't, it hurt a little bit, but for the most part, I was seeing the board pretty clearly. Let's take a look at these challenges again. Is keyboard shortcut still here? Ah, Zach. Okay, I'm gonna play Zach. I recognize you. He's actually one of my students. How's it going, Zach? Very nice young man. Hopefully he's still there. Thank you, Supreme Bot. Glad you liked that video on pawn breaks. Well, in Tony's defense, Craig, you never know because there's probably a stream delay going on. So he might not have been able to even hear my comments. Okay, Christoffo. I'm just kind of playing people at random. I'm sorry if I'm passing over your name, but I'm looking for people whose name I recognize. Hopefully you are there. All right. Let's play knight f6. Maybe we'll go for a Grunfeld, mix it up a little bit, different openings and such. So if c takes, I'll take with a knight, of course, get into a Grunfeld. He's playing a pretty conservative way with e3. See you later, evil second twin. E-player, what's your username on here? What's your username, Trevor? Cool, yeah, thanks, Toby. This will be uploaded in its entirety right after I wrap this up, which will probably be pretty soon. We've been going for, about 2.5 hours now. So yeah, we're gonna wrap this up soon. So one of the ideas in the Grunfeld is you try to attack the center from a distance. So I'm trying to play c5 and hit that d4 pawn. Attack the middle. So let's develop this. Get the knight working against d4 as well. What are your best results as an adult? Probably when I got my G Abnorm in 2013 in St. Louis. That was a very good tournament for me. I mean, go figure, if you're going to make a GM norm, you have a good tournament. Okay, here I can take either way on c3, probably with the knight is best. Then we'll take with the bishop thereafter. I'm going to pre-move that one. Guitar playa. I'm probably going to play some one-minute games just so we can get some people in there. So if you want to play, challenge me to 1 minute. But honestly, I'm probably not going to be streaming for too much longer. Rook b1. This is a bit annoying in regards to this pawn. And maybe queen c7. Just so I can develop my light square bishop so it's not... when I'm not just hanging this b pawn in all cases. Let's go bishop f5. Again, development. So I've got a slightly better pawn structure, but b7 could be tender. That's a good idea, Daniel. I should stream a simul. You're absolutely right about that. I think that would be fun. So I may try to do that in the future. Okay, so I want to pin that knight, but is bishop f3 going to be annoying? Let's go this rook over. And if bishop f3, maybe knight here. Okay, he's going to do that. Probably smart. Rook here. Yeah, he can take on c6 then. Okay, I think this is all right. He can also take f5, but he's not going to do it. Let's do this. And if f3, I think I have to take on d4, which might be okay. I can try to blockade the d5 square if he takes with the pawn. plays bishop f3. Let's take that guy. And then knight e5. Hit the queen. So I can just take here, right? I don't see any big problem with this move. Take the offered pawn. Take this pawn too. Greed is good. I guess he could trade and then play queen b5, attacking the knight and also the pawn on b7. So I've got a few weaknesses. Ooh, but now we get this move in. That is bad news for Cristoffo, because then we've got a rook coming down to c1 next move, and he'll have to part with his queen to stave off checkmate. All right, so thanks for the game, Cristoffo. Like I said, guys, I'm probably just going to play 1 minute from this point forward. Guitar player, I saw you were challenging me, so let's do that. Good luck to you, sir. 1162. Oatmate, yeah, someone asked about that earlier. I might play Hutch. We've been in talks, so we might do that. All right, Scandinavian. We got to get one Scandinavian game in today, at least. Knight back to g1. I'm not sure about that one, guitar player. But you have every right to be a little nervous under the bright lights of a Finn stream. It happens to the best of us, myself included, sometimes. Knight comes back out. Probably he should castle now. Okay, he's going to play bishop e3. I'm going to attack this bishop. Guitar, you're undeveloping your pieces. This is a little trick. If he takes the knight, I have knight takes c2 with the royal fork. Let's just develop and defend this guy. That knight on e3 is a bother because white can't castle. I mean, not only is black up a piece, but also white can't get their king out of the center either. So truly some big issues. Have you seen that you can play a simul on Lee Chess? Yes. Yep, I'm aware of that you can play a simul on Lee Chess. This is a discovery, wins the queen. Take here, I'm also threatening queen takes d3 now. With checkmate. Thanks for the game, guitar player Bray. Let's go back, take a couple other challenges. Okay, Dragon, you were asking to play. Is that a 1 minute game? Yes, it is. Okay, Dragon Phoenix Slayer, good luck. Let's hit you with the Sicilian. Yes, I'm not a Star Wars fanboy by any means. Well, I gotta pick up my speed here. Dragon Phoenix is fast. Let's play d6. He can't develop his dark square bishop yet because he would lose that pawn on b2. Maybe I should sink my knight into d4 before he goes d4. He's going to play it before I get a chance. Ooh, he takes that way. But I like this now because now I have a dark square bishop that is potentially strong. He should have taken with the knight. Would have been much better. Now I think black can be very satisfied with the position. Not going to take that c3 knight. Let's just develop. Bring our bishop out to b7. Can I take this one? Snatchity snatch. Snatch another pawn. All right, I'll trade that. Then we'll get our rook over here, try to swap. b2 is a little bit weak for him. Okay, take that guy. Now we get in and we're hitting these two pawns. Ooh, hung the rook. I was concerned at the outset of this game because this guy's very fast, but our position is too strong now. Let's go attack his knight. Okay, good game, Dragon Phoenix. What's your name, Edmund? Tell me your username. Because I know you were asking a little bit earlier. Chess Liker 2. Okay. Why don't I see you? Oh, there you are. Challenge me in 1 minute, though. I think 3 minutes is a little bit long, given all the people we have. Okay, ePlayer. Another frequent stream participant and YouTube watcher, ePlayer on LeeChess, aka Trevor. But yes, Adnan, challenge me again with 1 minute. We'll play. Are you there, ePlayer? You're not responding. Oh, finally. Okay. We've got a game. I was about to abort that. Let's play for E4. Oh, ePlayer, you blundered the same way before against me. You can't do this, man. You gotta be careful. You gotta be more cautious. Okay, I'm gonna drop this back and then get the other knight in so I can play F3. That's the plan here. Okay, let's take that. Because he's gonna have a pretty bad dark square bishop. Both bishops, really. Attack. Okay, let's go take this. Oh, I could have taken E6. That would have been much, much better. We can take here now. And this rook is looking destitute. Take this guy. ePlayer is in trouble. D4 is defended. We don't have to worry about that. Okay, let's just play queen up. Connect our stuff together here. Okay, I'm going to come here. I'm not sure I'm playing this well. Rook E8 is possible, and then I have to play like queen takes F5. Looks a little strange. It's probably still good, but yeah, it could have been better. Whoa, I have like very little time left. Oh, nasty. Gross. Okay, let's go back here. I couldn't take because I would hang D1 if I were to do so. Let's give a check. Give a check again. Check here. Open up the attack on the bishop. I think we're going to get ePlayer on the clock, ultimately. Okay, so we beat ePlayer. Nice to play you, Trevor. I'm going to play two more games, and then we're going to call it quits, guys. So, Chess Liker, here's your chance if you challenge 1 minute. Instead, I'm just looking. All right, you did. Okay, and then I'm going to play Colin to wrap up the stream. Because I modded him so late today. Chess Liker 2. Good luck. Okay. Yeah, Zach, you and I can definitely play. I think I'm going to wrap up the stream soon, but you and I can definitely play since we know each other. We can always play at a more convenient time. Okay, I'm going to go knight d4 and pile up on f3. Let's take that. We'll go here, and I want to go knight e5. My next move, so he's going to push me back. Let's play rook b8 and go for b5, b4. Push the pawn. Go attack b2. Defend the d5 square as well. Make sure he can't jump in. Maybe go for d5. Yeah, pawn d5. I'm dropping a5, but if he takes it, his knight gets really sidelined. Let's go here. His knight's going to get pushed way back if he continues like this. I think I'm going to take here. I hope I don't get trapped. I don't think I will. If rook a1, queen takes b2. I know this looks super risky.
But I've done way riskier things in chess. All right, c4, let's keep pushing. Keep the pressure on. Let's back up the queen now. I'm gonna sack. Because why not? Let's go here. I wanna go rook e8 now. And attack his queen and unleash some fury on this long diagonal. Okay, let's go here. Knight is pressured. Check. Go win the material back. Check again. Let's play b3 next. Pick up the rook. Okay, so we beat Chess Liker. And Colin, you are up next. If I can find you. There you go. All right, this is going to be the last game. Good luck, Colin. You should be on monster.com per your admission of being unemployed, but we'll forgive you for wanting to play some chess. All right, let's go bishop g4. Maybe try to disrupt his development a little bit. Knight bd7. I'm going to do something kind of forceful here. And probably bad, but we'll see how Colin reacts. I'm just going to try to advance in the center. I think maybe d5 would have been better for him there. Okay, let's do this. Probably queen e2 and going after the c4 pawn is smart now. Let's castle. Ah, he can take and then play bishop d6. Oh, but I have rook e8 always. Never mind. Okay, let's do this. Now I can always support my pawn with b5. You gotta support your extra pawn whenever possible. Okay, let's try to bring over our king now. Like, get our king over to e8, cover the d7 square, and maybe advance from there. We'll just guard c6. Okay, let's play a6. Bring our king up a bit. I'm thinking c5 next. c5, c4. Probably a good plan. Start trying to make use of our extra pawn. Let's put this there. We're going to attack his pawns. Colin's doing a good job. He's putting up some good defense here. Just doesn't have any time left is the problem. All right. So, good game, Colin, and thank you to all of those who challenged. Sorry I didn't get to play everyone. And thank you to everyone for tuning in. It was a lot of fun. We went for almost 3 hours, and we lost the match, but on the whole, I think it was some good games, and I'm glad I was able to interact with you guys. We still have almost 500 people watching even now. I think there was close to 900 even at the peak when I glanced over there. So once again, really appreciate you guys tuning in. I'm going to have more of these streams in the future. Hope you found it enjoyable. Hope you learned something. And maybe I can get my revenge on Jan sometime in the near future. So, all right, guys, enjoy the rest of your week, and I'll talk to you later. Bye.